You recall that I talked a great deal about pattern integrity. And there is one episode in my life that I think really dramatizes the pattern integrity. In 1930, I was asked to speak at Dartmouth University. And I had my Dimax in-house at that time in Marlow. And they had me speak in the Dartmouth Hall, which was a very old hall there. And all went well. Many years went by, and I was asked in 1947, 17 years later, to come back to Dartmouth to speak. And I spoke again in Dartmouth Hall, but in the meantime, there had been a great fire, and Dartmouth Hall had been burned up, and they were so fond of it, they built an exact replica. So I was introduced as to the audience, and having been there 17 years ago, and when I then began to speak, I said I didn't like to be contradictory, but I'd never been there before. Because I said Dartmouth Hall had burnt down, so we obviously went to the same building. And in the meantime, 17 years, all my cells had changed. There was nothing of the only thing that really had any identity were my eyeglasses, which hadn't changed. So here we had an artifact of one of the extracorporeal extensions of human beings that I spoke to you about, which was really more permanently part of the pattern of me than any of my flesh or bones. So that the audience really understood quite well what I was talking about in the pattern integrity. I'm going to talk now about what my strategy, my feeling as we go along now about how I carry on. I've certainly, obviously, done my best to present to you a grand strategy of problem solving. I brought you into some mathematical thinking about that. And I've done my best to introduce large patterns, because we know why I've done that, that if we see enough pattern, we may have a chance to discover some of the repetitive, the periodic relationships that are occurring, and we can really witness fundamental change in the evolutionary relationship of human beings to the universe. But I have in my storage here several other large pattern considerations that I employ a great deal, and I must get those out of the way, and then I'm going to gradually come in much more tightly on the energetic geometry. We just touched a few items there, and I'm going to come in on what are called design science. I'll come in on our world game, and I'll come down to great deal of where we are on our planet right now, what I see going on with all humanity, and particularly what I feel the little human individual can do, but each little human being is so aware of so many other human beings, and the planet being so big, and the complexity of things that are already operative when you check in the picture and the automobiles are rushing by, whatever it may be, doesn't seem very good prospect to the individual. He's going to be able to be very effective in this great big pattern. He might expect to be fairly effective in a local pattern with a few people, but what the human little individual human can do about humans on board of our planet in a big way seems for the moment pretty formidable challenge. So I will talk more about that with you, because I'm confident the little individual can do a great deal, and every one of the human individuals are going to be able to do a great deal. And if you catch on to the strategies that I employ, you may be able to employ them too. You may want to. I've talked to, but tonight I'm I'm going to clean up two or three items. One thing I've talked a great deal to you about is precession. And we mentioned it a number of times, and you now know what it is I refer to when I say precession. And I'm now going to talk much more about it, because I find that, at least it seemed to me very clearly in evidence long, long ago, that the gap between the humanities and the sciences I hope this all stays in the picture. The gap between the humanities and the sciences that C.P. Snow talks about in The Two Worlds, I feel is one that is spannable, and since C.P. Snow wrote his book, we have met and have talked with him a great deal about it, and he tells me he has changed his mind now. He does think it can be spanned. And I felt when I was young that there were so many things that I could see and feel very clearly, but I kept looking then for scientific concepts, principles, which I did not feel that I or other human beings tended to sense very clearly. And of all the big ones, I came to precession is by far seemed to me the least sense. You have the words, and I'm going to just go through some things of a child. The fundamental spontaneous participation of a child in the permitted degrees of freedom of our universe. And this, what I'm saying makes me think that I may start a little further away from the immediate demonstration precession, and because I think these are so interconnected, these child experiences, that I'd rather start a little earlier in the child experience thinking. And as in the previous nights, I have told you I was going to do a little digression, but I will not forget where we are at all. I've thought a whole lot about what is the relationship of the grown-up to the child and relation to what everybody discussed a great deal, education. And I mentioned to you the other night, trying to identify as close as I could what it was that I personally was conscious of doing when I say I'm thinking, recognizing there was a great deal of spontaneity of preoccupation, and subconscious things do occur, that we find that our brain does seek for information when we ask it a question. And think about the relationship of the older people to children, and the idea that the child is not an empty container which the grown-ups then gradually insert their knowledge and their wisdom. That the child has incredibly high potential. The faculties that are there, the way they could really be used if they're not frustrated by circumstances, and circumstances could be animate or inanimate, and going to our friend pattern integrity. I want you to think about a little child being born, as we said time and again, absolutely helpless for months, can't even move itself around, naked, beautiful equipment but no experience, therefore ignorant. So this had a little child, and the little child has been, his mother so used to the idea of this little child is helpless, that she moves around and she lays in the crib and so forth, and the child is lying on the bed, and as a much time going on, the child is growing, and its feet are growing long, legs are getting longer, and its feet are weighing more, its hands are weighing more, and so forth. And there comes a day when the child is lying on the bed, mother's left him there, and he is moving his terminals, which he's been doing for a long time, and suddenly the child gets his leg up like this, and an arm the same time, he didn't realize it, and it overweights him, and he rolls over. And nobody around, mom hasn't moved me. This is great. I didn't know I could do that. So the child, what was it I did? So keep doing this, and over it goes again. Very often children roll the edge of the bed and go off. And luckily they're designed hydraulically, pneumatically, as we've talked about, and so they can take really quite a fall and a punch like that. That just distributes the load so beautifully, the hydraulics. It doesn't do any harm. But there's a great memory of something that happened as a consequence of moving around experimentally on your own. You had a little trouble here. Something hurt. So that we have a little child then crawling around on the floor, and then gradually climbing up and things. There's something around here that mother isn't around here. There's something every time I try to do this, she's doing this to me. And I, this, a lot going on around here without mom. The thing is around here all the time, keep moving everything this way. So finally, the little child does learn to stand up. So, but it's very, very conscious of this thing. So the little child's feeling that, and the running around the house, and the, suddenly see the banisters. Now, I want to realize also in this little child doing this, also wants to get back up, wants to get climb up and things right away. He got a feeling of sort of working against this thing goes that way. So he learns about getting up on the up on the things like that. And then coming off of it, he's learned that he, wish I had him all around me. He's learned to he's on the bed, and he remember about, he wants to get off the bed. They laid him on the bed. So he wants to get off, and he learns, he can angle himself up like this. Something to do about angles. When he got angles like this, I have to go further. So he can do that. But he angles up like that, and then pushes back a leg here. So he angles himself like this. Now his legs are out over the edge of the bed. And he remembers that it hurt very much when you let go. So he learns to angle like this, and every time he gets a little too far, he learns he can do this. And so he changes his position. Finally, let's go and goes here. Now, what he has been doing, this mysterious phenomenon that's around him, he doesn't have words for phenomenon, he doesn't have words mysterious, he just feels these things very powerfully. There's something here that when he does this way, he accelerates, and when he does this, it goes the brakes on. So he's got both an accelerator and a brake. It feels pretty bad, pretty dangerous. I want to get my legs as near as I can to the floor before I let go. So you keep putting on the brakes and finally you're going to go. And so I've learned then there's an angle control. There's something about vertical and something about horizontal. He doesn't have the words, any such words. And A little child running around there sees the banisters in the house, and that angle looks kind of familiar to him. So that's sort of a critical angle, halfway between the accelerator and the brakes. And by the time he's been holding on to a lot of things, cramping, so I feel I can hold on to those banisters, and that angle there, I'll start sliding. So nobody around me climbs up, and sure enough, he let go of it, hold on again, puts on the brakes, and he found a beautiful ride. So now there's something around him all the time, that's not mom and nothing, that gets him from here to there. So this child feels very strongly that coasting business, the angle of the acceleration he has. Suddenly there was a winter day, he'd never seen winter before, and out comes out of the front porch, and it's all snowy and ice in the city, and he sees that angle on the steps there, and he starts to go out, or walking out, and he never had ice or snow before, and didn't realize it was going to be slippery. He's used to the floors that are not slippery. And he goes sliding down the first steps to the street. He said, boy, that's great. So I don't want to do it. Hurts my back. So he quickly finds something he can sit on and starts doing it. The children are fantastically inventive about it, and finding something they can coast on. Now this little child, the parents always afraid that children are going to get themselves in trouble. And I'll just point out to you, this child is perfectly spontaneously full of the awareness when he let go. The further he is from the floor, the more it sits. So there's something about height. There's also, if it's angular, if the angle feels right, he doesn't have any words yet, doesn't use the word angle, but he feels angle, absolutely, completely. You know, just is hunching himself up like that. It can be more angular. Nothing more, as his hands have been doing all that time, his arms have been doing, he's angling. The angles are very, very familiar to him. And he has angular controls. So, what's he doing, this grasping like that? This angular control. So he feels very strongly the angle, and he understands that horizontal, because the street is horizontal. I say he doesn't use the word horizontal, but the street is horizontal, which means brakes. It's going to stop. Therefore you feel, as long as you can see at the bottom where it comes level, you perfectly well dare just to go down the slide. Because you really felt there was some little friction, quite different from a free drop, as long as the right angle feeling. So kids really judge this coasting thing very powerfully. Anybody telling what to do? So I now have this child that's learned, and I say, no child will go over a cliff. Parents say, I'm terrible, this child will go off the cliff, will go off the house. They couldn't be more aware of the hurt there. They automatically do not get in trouble. They only do these things when they can see the horizontal. They see the brakes. Couldn't be more logical. I had this little child who had never been out of the city, and this little child comes into the PAL and they go television, and they're having the ski trials for the Olympic ski trials in Hokkaido, Japan, and this little child is in Philadelphia, never been out of Philadelphia. And he sees there's quite a mountain there. Well, he's had a pile of pillows on his bed, he can understand the hill, the feeling of a hill fine, just a big one. And he could see then that angle, and he feels that feels good to him, and he sees the snow, and that seems good to him. So everything that goes on there in the skiing looks absolutely logical to him. And what the skier is doing, he's got an angle, he's angling his using angles on his ankles, and totally angling, as he comes down. Everything's angled, positioned to angle. The child feels it absolutely, completely logical to him. Now what I'm getting at, coincidentally, I was asked to come and speak in Aspen, Colorado in the winter, and it was 1972. And the professional who started Aspen as a ski run after the army used it for training. The professional first, they first had there to really turn it into a ski resort was Island, and Island was still there in 72. I don't know whether it still is. And Island said to me, "Have you ever skied?" And I said, "No, I never did. I did a great deal of skating, but I never did skiing. I guess I'm much too old." He said, "Not necessarily." He said, "If you'd like to, you have to get the right equipment to get you properly fit out. If you like, I'll take you out and see how you do really get on." So we went at it for 2 or 3 days, and he said I could ski. And then I felt very, very, very obligated to this man. He was the professional. He was doing this all for nothing for me and taking a tremendous amount of time. We were having hot tea and coffee after skiing, and I told him what I just told you, and I said that I'm now going to give you the scientific description of skiing. I'm going to give you the scientific generalization of skiing. It's called angular valving of gravity. He said, "I never thought of it. That's exactly right." Isn't that interesting, really? There is a pattern in integrity. We're getting really out of generalizations. We find that, and that this great skier really felt that was absolutely accurate, and he enjoyed it tremendously. This then relates to what I feel about education. That is, I'm absolutely confident that the child and the human being must teach itself. It must really find out. It has to have confidence as it goes. You've got to get a feeling of what it is all about. Then, what the teacher can do is then, if the child has experienced a little of that, then the teacher can do what the television did. They can tell you that there's a great big mountain instead of just a little hill out in front of the house, and the same principle is going to work. So the teacher must really only amplify what it is that the child already feels and feels very, very deeply. And they assume that the child didn't feel it because they never had the word gravity or horizontal. It's absolute nonsense. those are very limited special ethnic experiences, and the communication is already, the lines are open, and whatever words happen to be used are fine, and the child will take on the words as long as it's identifying what it feels. Now, this brings me back then, as I said, to precession, thinking about precession. And I have a little child, and the little child then we found learned it could roll over. That was a whole lot. It was something, not the original experience at all. So then little child, when he does finally stand up, having actually rotated, then little child very quickly finds children trying this. They have a lot of fun spinning around. So then, that is one of the prime motions of our universe. We have axial rotation of our planet. We have, the axial is a very, very fundamental to the universe. Then we have the same little child learning that not only that, but he can also go into orbit, go around the circuit. Then he finds that he can go into orbit while actually rotating too, and so we call that dancing. So we've got two very important motions of the universe here. Then the little child learns that it can take in its breath, expand and contract. Very fundamental motion of the universe. We've got three very important ones here. Now another one he can do is to twist his top one way and his bottom the other way. We call that twist in dancing now, but torque. So torque, we have axial, orbital, expansion, contraction, torque, four of them. Now another one is a very fundamental. You just start kissing. Try to turn yourself inside out. I gave you the rubber glove the other day. Evoluting. A rubber donut, remember? Evoluted at the top and involuted at the bottom. So the child starts finding that involuting, evoluting. It's a pattern getting in all of electromagnetics and so forth. Well, there are five most fundamental motions in the universe which the child is spontaneously familiar with, and you can talk about. But the word precession, we come to that, and the child's kind of blank, and the first child experience of precession that he might be able to catch on to is when his uncle brings him a top. And the uncle brings a top and has quite a time winding it up, and then after a while gets the top going. So the top is actually rotating very rapidly, but also so it has a secondary very slow motion. It's leaning way over like this. And the little child has learned when he leans way over like that, he keeps on going. So he said, "Uncle, why doesn't it fall over? It was leaning." So Uncle said, "I got to get a cigar," and that's the end of that. The reason, of course, is precession. And the reason he was familiar with these other five is that he seemed to do them all alone. One of the things that engineering tried to remind the non-engineer about is that every action has a reaction. But to a little child, the fact that he is doing this doesn't make him realize he's pushing the earth that way, though. He's so tiny, the earth is so big, just as there's no such awareness. But of course, he is affecting that planet, and an incredibly meager degree, but he's doing so. Now, precession, I said, was the effect of bodies in motion on other bodies in motion. So he really was doing a precessional thing to this, but he's unaware of doing it. So the first five are familiar because they seem to be within yourself. And you do not think of the earth as in motion even, let alone that you could push it a little. I can understand that why precession has been so, in a sense, remote from the basic thinking of the individual feeling himself very independent on what seemed to be a flat earth going to infinity. And he's the only thing in motion. Now, precession, the science and technology advisor on the staff of Fortune magazine for 2 years. They had no editorial titles on Fortune, so that they did not put that on the articles when I wrote. But my job was to, when Fortune was taking one big corporation after another and explaining the great enormous work that corporation was doing and explaining which executives had the highest initiative and so forth, they did very good stories on these corporations. But the managing editor brought me on to Fortune and Henry Luce at that time in 1938 wanted me to try to bring home to the readers of Fortune a little more insight into the science technology that really lay behind that great corporation's activity. And each one of the, I was only put on stories where the technology was something difficult. And when I came to do those stories, the chief scientist, the vice president in charge of research and engineering, whatever it might be, would always say to me, "It's going to be impossible for you to tell the Fortune readers what it is we are concerned with in depth in science here in our company, because it can only be expressed mathematically. And the Fortune readers don't read the mathematics, and very few of them do, therefore there's no way you can talk to them." And I had been given a double spread for each of my stories to tell. And every instance I was able to tell the Fortune reader what it was they engaged in depth without recourse to just the mathematical formulas. I was able to bring it into some sensibility that I just gave you, the same kind of sensing, identification of experience of your own body. And so we came to doing the Sperry Gyroscope Company in 1940. World War II was looming. Sperry not only had the gyroscope, they were in a Norden bomb site, and it was a very critical, from a national defense policy, it was a critical area, and yet they did not feel it would be in any way putting that operation into jeopardy to have me talk something about the technology. And right, the very essence of the Sperry Gyroscope Company was a gyroscope. And the gyroscope is, does what it does, as pure precession, which is employed. They said, just to show you how impossible your task is with double spread, we have to have a primer for the Naval Academy midshipmen, because the Navy uses so many gyroscopes for so many controls that the naval officer has to have some important insights and what he's dealing with. Therefore, we have this primer, and it takes 50 pages to tell the Naval Academy midshipmen about precession in an important way, and it's entirely quantum mechanics. So that they said, your task is impossible. Now, I did, and I had only 30 days to work on the story, and I did come out with the explanation of the precession and the gyroscope, which I made, brought it to your own senses, and did clarify, and the scientists of a Sperry Company said they really were astonished, but they agreed that it was not just a sort of happy analogy I was using, it was absolutely the direct explanation. And they had not realized it could be expressed in terms of senses, because it seemed to be a very perverse matter. Precession seemed to be a very perverse thing, like a kid saying, why doesn't the top fall over? Now, there are several matters that are going on in the precession where we're dealing in accelerations, and there are two kinds of accelerations that are recognized by the physicists. They're what they call linear and angular. Linear are obviously like that, or angular, but just think about then swinging the weight around your head, the hammer thrower. It is angular acceleration while you're having some restraint on it and you're making it work in a circle, and you let go of it, and then it goes linear. Radial versus circumferential. Now, the precessional one I spoke to you about is that, and we're going to try to have some sense of understanding why it is, because I'm sure that most people then, they feel that the gravity is 180 degrees, the Earth, for instance, ought to fall into the Sun, and why there's an effect of the Sun on the Earth make it go in orbit around it at 90 degrees instead of falling in. This is one reason why it seems perverse, because everybody really, the child really thinks about that gravity pulling this way. It's very 180 degree fair, and it's just, human beings get to be very linear this way. They want to explain things very linearly. They're looking this direction. So now I'm going to go into some explanation. I'm going to think about a athlete we call a hammer thrower, and we have the heavy weight ball, metal ball, and a rod, and two triangular handles for this professional hammer throwing. And he is lying on the ground, he gets into acceleration, and as he gets into acceleration, he gets it out horizontal. And then here we get into something quite important, because he can actually build energy or momentum into the system as he gets accelerating this weight, and he gets going faster, and really using his muscles to get enormous acceleration. Otherwise, you can accumulate energy in this angular acceleration, and so when he does let go of it, then it goes off in a line with that angular acceleration, how far he throws it, how much energy really got built into the system. I'm going to have a special apparatus for our, we're going to have a great Olympic hammer thrower, and we have a wide belt made from a very powerful belt, and has many hooks on it, powerful hooks. And we get him start one of these accelerations. He gets his ball accelerating, and we get him to hook it onto his belt, and we give him another one. He gets that going too, along with it. That's probably be in the opposite direction, because just balancing the weights very spontaneously. He gets that hooked onto his belt too. Now he's built up quite a motion. He can't really stop very much. So we can him another one. Keep giving him one of these and get one by one, he gets him accelerated and hooks him onto his belt. So finally he has really a whole grass skirt horizontally out here of all these balls, and there's so much momentum built into it that he cannot really stop himself. And he would be in a lot of trouble, so we've anticipated by the floor that he was on, we had already made a turntable, very nice turntable, ball-bearing turntable, but we'd had it locked so he could get it, shove off and get his acceleration. But now we release the table so it can spin right for him. And we also then make him really comfortable. We bring down a ball-bearing pad on his head from his arm from above. And so he's between the floor and the it's moving around very easily. So the balls can just can build all that momentum. So it just gets, he's spinning around it. The balls, he gave so many, they're touching one another. And we now then, I'm going to leave him spinning for a minute. In fact, we're going to another man who's not really Olympic game. He has a mouthful of plastic peas, and he's got a tube, aluminum tube, plastic, and he's a pea shooter, and he's blowing peas out of the end of the tube. And we could use other things. A machine gun would hurt you if you put your finger in the way. We could use a hose of water, but you can't see the individual molecules. But pea shooter is very convenient because you can see the individual peas coming out. And if it blows good and hard, they go out fairly far. So you find that with the peas coming out, you can come over and put your finger in the trajectory of the peas. And if you put your finger and come in from the side like that, you make it deflect over there, can't you? Or you put a little bit under it and make it pop up a little. You can change it angularly. This is our friend angular valving. So we can change the trajectory. Now the fact is that no matter how hard he blows, it only goes away before gravity pulls it to the earth. And so the gravity blowing, if you don't put your finger there, deflecting, there's no wind. As he blows it, the pea goes operates in a plane, and the plane is perpendicular to the earth as gravity pulls it in it. So you could really describe this as a curve on a plane. So what happens when you put your finger there to move it on one side of the trajectory of the peas? You simply make a change like that and gravity still takes over. What you really do is push up the plane in which the pea is operating, you push it a little this way. Right? Feel that? Then if I remove my finger, the pea doesn't act as if there's an elastic band and try to go back to where it had been at all. It's simply, it's been changed its angle, and gravity is also changing. It's got two forces operating on the pea. Three forces, the original acceleration, then my deflection and gravitational deflection. There are two angular deflections operating on it. But the point is that it does not then have memory and try to go back to what it was doing before. You understand that completely? The pea simply, if I push my finger, the next pea will then go over here. So it has each pea has, however, then a plane which it moves in. If we put the permanent finger here into the trajectory and left it there, all the peas would follow the same plane. You didn't push it any further. The plane could be reoriented, but the point is, the minute you stop pushing it, it holds that plane. It does not try to come back to where it was before. Now, I'm going to run. Now we've learned individual peas can be deflected, and we can push one a little further than the other. But the individual can be, and once you've given his new angle, it's going to keep right on, and it's now only being affected by the gravity. Gravity is the other one that's altering it, the only one. Now I'm going to come back to this. Now that we've learned what happens in individual pellet, I recognize then this hammer thrower going around here. These are individual pellets that he has out there. their individual energy units, and they're very much heavier than the pea, but they follow the same laws exactly. If it had cannonball coming out and had some kind of a steel finger you could put in the way, you could make the same deflection. Now, I'm going to point out that the ball-bearing turntable we had underneath the hammer thrower and the ball-bearing pad on his head, each one of them were mounted on arms, a vertical arm going that way and a vertical arm going that way, and they were mounted from an annular ring, a great big annular ring. And the annular ring would go 90 degrees around on it from this pivotal point, and we got another set of hinges, of trunnions. We built what we call, and then that's mounted another ring. Get what you call gimbals, if you've seen gimbals for a gyroscope in the it has now all XYZ axi of a rotatability. So this man is spinning and he's in gimbals. Now I'm going to have him spinning out here in front of me so that you can see what. Maybe I'll do it. I'll have him spinning over here. And I'm going to come over as those individual pellets go by, hammers. If I put my finger down in here, maybe I put something guard on it so it won't hurt too much. If I put my finger down and touch one of those balls, I'm going to deflect it. Agree? So I keep my finger there, and the next one, so once I've deflected it, it doesn't have any memory, want to come back, so as the balls are going around, this one I touch it, and it goes down like that. But it had another restraint, which was the rod pulling it, which was just as the pea had gravity pulling it, its own acceleration had been, gravity was no longer affecting it. You can do that. But the point is that the rod was really tantamount to the gravity that pulled on the pea. So after I touch it, the rod is still holding on to it. So this pellet went by me here, I touched it, it goes down like that. But it's on a rod, so it's going to go around in a circle. So I keep my finger there and touch each of these pellets as they go by, and each of them peels off. I've had a nice mathematical control for my finger, so I just give it exactly the same touching. And each one of them peels off like that, one after the other, very much like airplanes coming along in a flight and they suddenly peel off. All of them, one after the other, they get into then a new plane. The wheel which had been revolving horizontally here, you can see the man's in front of me here, and I've just touched it at this point. So each one of those pellets goes slanting down like that. From where I touched it, it slants like that, but then it stays in and goes around and comes up on the other side. So as each one, the moment's really terrific bending of this thing, because it's been a very severe angle as you touch it, but it goes off. In fact, I keep my finger, they've all gone by, and the whole thing's changed. It means then that the plane that I had been dealing in, I wish I had a little larger disc. Could you let me have your book? So I touched the pellet here, and one by one, and they slant like that, because I did that. Can you see that? My deflection was this way as it went by, so this does this. But it was restrained, so it stayed. The whole disc then does this, which means then that the axle of that wheel also then has to stay perpendicular, because we had him this very wide belt, and he just normally has to do this. So the whole gimbal permitted it. There were hinges on the end of the ring here, the horizontal end of the ring, so the whole thing is able to hinge that way. So when I touch it here, the whole disc changes like that. But the axle just goes over. See that? Feels absolutely normal to what I told you, doesn't it? Nothing wrong with it. That's exactly what these wheels do. So now, I had a hammer thrower, but I, instead of, I want to do a little more. When you do touch a gyrating wheel, a rotating wheel like that, there's enormous strain in it, because you're really touching it individual parts, and they're trying to really break the wheel in two. However, if before I had touched one of those pellets, I had, as they went around, I had draped very powerful Scotch tape on top of it, glass Scotch tape, and it went all the way around. We would have a condition where these balls are touching each other and there's a tape, a tension tape on top of them. Therefore, if I touch this ball here, the blue one, on top, it's going to do this. It's against here, and then it's tensioned across so that it's simply going to pull like this. And this acts as a fulcrum, and it lifts on the one behind this, the third ball behind, as this one goes down, it's going to lift the one behind it. As tension in the system, on top of the system, if I touch this here, it'll work back all through the whole wheel, so it helps the whole wheel to tip a little faster. Because not only is it the one I'm touching going down, but the one behind gets lifted. But all around the same axis as they're going around here. The axis between you and me, because I'm touching it here, and it's going in that plane there. Now, then I point out that instead of putting the tape on the balls, I'm going to give the hammer thrower twice as many more balls and have him spin them and get him loaded up. Now, you find that the first set, the acceleration is such that they were out horizontally in respect to his waist. And I've given him twice as many, so he gets a layer on top and a layer on bottom, and they are trying to go horizontal, so they press together on the ones that are already there. They'll nest in the valleys of them and grip them very tightly. If I gave them all layers, they all try to get into the horizontal plane, so they grip it even tighter. So it begins to act as a unit material and has the same tension effects as that tape I gave you. So this then I was more or less describing really what a flywheel looks like that you have in your gyroscope. But we understand the very center of that wheel has in its individual atoms, and really must be thought of as individual quanta doing just what I said. I've shown you how the quanta do the friction and the intertensioning of this, the friction of the one ball on top of the other, would make it do it. We had the mass intertraction of the balls too. So you now understand that instead of thinking about the man as a man, I want you to think about it as a steel axle perpendicular to the wheel. So I simply tell you, if a gyroscopic wheel is moving in gimbals in front of me high speed, if I touch it, you've probably heard of the finger. If you take any tiny little metal finger, just touch it here, the whole wheel does just what I said. It's going around this way, I touch it right here, and it rotates this way. Let me show you, understand, in front of me here. And there's an axis between you and I, and it rotates on that axis. Now, instead of touching the wheel, if it were made out of steel, there's a steel axle. Supposing then, instead of my pushing down on the wheel here, I leaned in over the thing and took hold of the top of the axle, or took hold of the top of the gimbals of where the gyroscope is mounted, and I pull the top towards me, it would be the same as if I pushed down here, wouldn't it? So rotating this in this plane. My force is in this plane between you and I and the circle there. So if I took hold of the top, pulled it towards me, then I would get exactly the same result as if I pushed down here. So you do try that with a gyroscope, so you pull it on here, and it doesn't yield to you, it goes over to your right. Now suddenly I want you to realize, I've brought you clearly through so you understand, but people say that's very perverse. I push on the top of a gyroscope thing here, instead of it's yielding to me, my pushing, it goes at right or left. It goes in the plane at 90 degrees. This is why my precession has been considered so difficult to understand, because human beings think it ought to go. If I push on it, it ought to yield the way I'm pushing it. And the fact is then if I push on it, it goes to the right. If I push on it harder, it goes faster. and it keeps going to the right as fast. So if I keep pushing on it, the whole thing keeps going around in a circle this way. The whole thing, the axle will be going around a circle not the direction I'm pulling, but in a plane perpendicular to me. If the wheel had originally been going the other way, it'll go that way. So long as I push it, it keeps on. If I push it harder, it goes faster. The minute I stop, everything stops. It doesn't have a memory to try to be something else at all. You can understand that, right? Now, this is the gyroscope, and I hope I've really introduced you why you felt the way through. Now, if I didn't bring in the paradox of the way you feel until the end, so that you really could feel it with me all the way, everything went on, it was absolutely normal. It's exactly what your experience tells you will happen. So I find that the error has been in humanity really thinking 180 degrees. And you say, anybody can throw a straight ball. Now what really goes on when you throw the straight ball? The pitcher may get a part of a circle and wind up like this. He just sends them out. And it goes over like this. Pitching. Now the fact is, the pitcher, you're looking that way, and you've been throwing balls for an awful long time. You say, I'm throwing that way, therefore I throw it there. You don't. He lets go here. At 90 degrees from the direction he wants to go, and then goes in that direction. He may go on with his finger to put spin on it, which he does. And he doesn't try to stop himself right away, but the point is that his acceleration is this way, you let go. And goes at 90. I want you to make that a little clearer. You're playing tennis, you're serving. You throw a ball up here and you hit it at 90 degrees, it goes over there. We've always been operating at 90, and we're absolutely kidding ourselves and thinking that we're throwing the ball out here. We don't throw it out here at all. If we throw it out here, it goes in the ground. Now, this is good fun to catch ourselves in ways in which we've been able really to deceive ourselves into what it is we're really doing. The precession couldn't be more normal. What's abnormal is that we've kidded ourselves and thinking you get 180 degrees. Trouble was the shooting of a gun, that fooled you. It's another kind of acceleration. You tensed your bow, the bow was vertically, and you tensed it this way and it went that way. And just come back to when I remember the rope, I took a piece of rope and I pulled on the rope. The more I pulled on it, the tauter it became, which meant that while I'm pulling it this way, it's going into compression at 90 degrees of my pulling. Remember that? The other day when I loaded in compression with all these rods, already in closest packing, they couldn't go towards each other. So as I blowed them, they all began to cigar. And the binding that I had around went into was offset by this pressure. So my compressioning got a 90 degrees tension, and the tension got 90 degrees compression at 90 degrees. And I gave you the electromagnet when it poached the copper coil. No. Electric current, you told, but just an electric magnet posting it, and it induces a current, and the current goes at 90 degrees. And the sets up a field that says 90 degrees, don't come any further to this magnet. I stop moving the magnet, everything stops. Precession stops. I start pulling the magnet the other way, as the copper wire becomes another current again, and sets up a field, tries to pull on, says, don't go away. Precession counter, it's completely regenerative. One brings out the other. So I gave you the other, dropping the stone in the water, and the wave went out that way. And this way beget that way, and that way beget that way. And that's why your circuit wave emanates. Once you begin to get into precession, you find yourself understanding phenomena that you've seen those stones falling in the water for all your life, never really knowing just why the wave does what it does. Well, I now quite confident that I've taken you into precession and given you very actually hooked up your own senses with it. There is another phenomenon in there that's very important, which is acceleration as also orbital, a precessional effect of the moon, of the Earth on the sun, the sun on the Earth, making us go into orbit around the sun. And then we are doing the same to that moon. And I find then it is an amazing matter that Professor Goddard was not understood, and it's an amazing matter how really beautiful was Goddard's accrediting what Isaac Newton had discovered, which I also went over with you the other day. Every time you halve the distance between the two masses, you increase their interattractiveness fourfold. If you double the distance away, you decrease the interattractiveness to one quarter what it had been. I know, nobody really paid attention to these kinds of things. In the personal way, in terms of their senses, Professor Goddard did. So he said, our Earth is already going around the sun at 60,000 miles an hour. And if we gave some object an acceleration, any object on board this planet is going also at 60,000 miles an hour. So this has to be going around the sun at 60,000 miles an hour, just in company with the Earth. So if we give any object an additional acceleration over that 60,000 to make it then begin to leave the planet, then every time it gets to, every time it doubles its distance out, it's going to reduce the tendency to fall in back in to one quarter what it was. You would not have to go very far out before you don't tend to fall in anymore. You just say in its own independent acceleration, its own orbiting. So this is Goddard, and it's a very simple matter. I find human beings again on board of our planet not tending to, we're so tiny and the total experience is so big, not tending to really get things into scale. But when we accelerate, and we were first told that the rocketed vehicles have gone into orbit, we thought of them as very far out, because our highest mountain, 5 miles above, when we get to our airplanes, many of them are flying at the jets at 40,000, 30,000, 40,000, and well above Mount Everest kind of thing. We get to 50,000 and you're, what are you? That's only 10 miles out. So we get, and at 50,000 you can't see the plane. So when that's only at only 10 miles out and you can't see it. So make 10 times that or 100 miles, and you just assume that's fantastically far out in the blue, that way it looks to you and I on our planet. But the fact is that our vehicles began to go into orbit at 100 miles out. Now the diameter of our Earth, 8,000 miles, and 100 miles in relation to 8,000, is a very small amount, isn't it? If I then take a thin paper match and glue it onto this globe here, that is 100 miles out from the surface of this globe. In other words, it would seem, look to you, exactly still in the globe still, but and now it's independent, it's in orbit. In other words, you don't have to go very far out in this universe before you get beyond what we call this critical proximity. You no longer tend to fall in. Falling in is a very, very rare part of our universe. Very seldom does anything get close enough to fall into anything else. The norm is orbit. And this 180-degree falling is something called critical proximity, when it really becomes part of this mass. Now, and when you get yourself feeling a new norm here, of the normality of precession, is also then I talked to you the other day about man and all the other creatures on board of our planet, and we went into how and why we're here, and I identified man as having a function in the universe, and that he, in order to get him ready for it, he had to go through being born naked and absolute ignorant, having to make trial and error to get somewhere, to learn generalized principles, where he could really then employ the principles to, as no other creature could, to make it possible for him to deal in larger and larger parts of the universe, and again, environments he'd never been in before, and get on appropriately to get more and more information, which is his function to process and to solve problems. So we had then all the biological life here to support and make possible that activity. We have we found that the mammals couldn't take any of the sun radiation through the skin to keep the energizing, re-energizing, which we all have to have, so that we remember then, I gave you the pattern of the trees being rooted in order to be able to do what they're doing, how they're getting the water and not to blow away. And then we found that because the vegetation was rooted, it couldn't procreate without the vegetation there. All the insects and many, many moving mobile creatures designed to traffic back and forth between all the vegetations to cross-pollinize them, so the whole system regenerates. So we have then the big thing is what we call the ecology, and really is an orbital affair. It is a cyclic affair, this way, and the and not this. But in order to get creatures to do these things, they give them chromosomic instruction. They're designed structurally, mechanically, beautifully, then given the chromosomic drive to go after the honey. I had then man going after his honey, called money honey, something he could exchange for goods, because he then inadvertently having had his hunger, but also having a procreative, which is inadvertently made children, because side effects, and it increases responsibility, so keeps going after this money honey more to try to take care of the side effects. And inadvertently begins then to do the things he's supposed to do. So I gave you then man with enormous fixation on the 180 degrees, but the precession and the orbiting is the normal. And that's what ecology is. This is eternally regenerative universe in all the ecology on our planet, then to support the human mind's activity to really deal in principles of universe and to solve local problems in pure principles, a very important function. So I hope I've now brought you back to really feeling the normality of the ecology and the normality of all the orbiting, and whether it's the orbiting of the electron around the nucleus, orbit. This is the normal of universe. All the inner effects of all most bodies in motion and all other bodies in motion in the universe is all precession. So I hope that instead of this being a word that seems remote to you now, it suddenly begins to be important. But it was also involved then in the picture I gave you of the hammer throw accelerating, that it wasn't horizontal. That is simply, again, if you accelerate an object on our planet enough, it tends to be independent. That's why a bicycle lying down on the ground is falling over, it yields to gravity. But you get on it, the minute you start going along, the faster you go, the more vertical and stiffer you are, because if you've got enough acceleration, you're going to leave the earth. That's all you need. In other words, you tend to be leaving the earth. So the acceleration had been given to those balls by the hammer thrower was such that gravity no longer was important. They were really tending to be free in the universe. So I hope I've made clear all the items that need to be cleared to make precession seem to you normal. And remember yesterday when I gave you this, suddenly the octahedron, and just precessed the effect on that the octahedron, one pull effect, but precessed that one vector, and it turned like that, and went from fourness to threeness, and went from being generalized case to specialized case. And really probably every time we go into all the special, you're going to, nature reserves with one increment and so forth. So this is how we have the invisible, where all the special cases are all finite and discontinuous. You see how they can be. Now, I'm going to go into another area. And we haven't been going on long enough for a break now. So that I talked to you about my maps the other night, and I will not as yet go into how these maps are designed. We'll do that as we get into the synergetic geometries and so forth. But I do want to come back to man on our planet. I had given you the exercise of thinking about little man on an 8,000-mile globe, and that we are only the highest mountains. Remember, we're not the deepest oceans. That aberration could not be seen on a 12-inch globe like this. So the actual fact is the ink with which we print the water on this globe is deeper than the water by a good deal. And so little you and I would be very invisible on such a phenomenon. Yet little you and I, in physical stature, having this mental capability that we looked into, to be able to take the inventory of all the chemical elements present in a 11.5 billion light year sweep out of the heavens, being able to develop the equipment to get into the invisible world of getting, and being able to photograph the stars and so forth, 99.9% of which are not visible to our naked eye. That human beings are able to, that you, tiny little you and I, are really able to deal with these magnificent scale affairs and to get the kind of information we're having. Now, coming then to the development of human beings on board of our planet, which I went into a little with you the other day, I would like to go through going from that concept of the being born naked and have to be a place where you would not be eaten up and would not freeze to death, and the coral atolls of the South Pacific being the most favorable possible place where you could be born and where there'd be no big animals to eat you up and so forth. I personally have been, this is highly speculative what I'm going to talk to you now about, but I was in regular United States Navy at the time of World War I. And I became tremendously interested in the possibility of what I call a sea archaeology versus a dry land archaeology. And all the archaeologists were digging in and uncovering old cities and so forth and putting together pieces. But it struck me very, very powerfully, because I was a sailor, was that the relative ignorance in the building of the land, we just piled stone on stone, in contradistinction to the what you really had to know about to be able to really build a successful boat, going from just a raft or a canoe, an outrigger, to big, deep-ribbed, big ships carrying incredible cargoes around our planet. And realizing, I'll just give you the, we went through the other day tensile strengths of mortar, you remember, and stone being 50,000 pounds of compression, only 50 in tensile, and that we got into the metals that had high tensile capability. Historically, in building, man then could, gravity just helped him, we could roll the stone over and get it to nest on top of other stone some kind of way, chip it so you get it lay there. Gravity held the whole thing together. And the stone was approximately, relatively imperishable, so it seemed to last a long time. And the great walls that were built by human beings that way would crumble down when earthquakes came, but otherwise they were pretty secure till an enemy might storm it and finally be able to knock down your wall. But the wall, this is the way things were built on the land. And the bigger and heavier and higher, the more secure people felt. And so we see all those castles, this kind of building. You could finally learn to have a stone corbel out, come a little way, and you get it out, so you get some fairly interesting designs after you're deeply familiar with them. But you still have to play with gravity. It's a sort of a game. Sure, don't tip too far out this way. There's a stone in here. So human beings then, dealing in almost completely compression and very poor tension capability. However, I want you to think about the what a beam is. I make my hand is going to be a beam. My two arms are worlds. I got a beam between the two worlds. I'm going to have a load on top here. As the load comes on top, the bottom tries to open up. As it tries to go like that way, the top goes into compression and the bottom goes into tension. and if the tension is not great, it just comes apart. So the whole thing comes down very quickly. Can you see that right? That's opening up. So when the Greeks then wanted to do some spanning, they had to get the columns very close to each other, and then they could get a very deep block of stone, because you have your principle of leverage. The top is the fulcrum, and the deeper the stone is, the longer your lever arm, so that you know the further, longer lever your arm, the less effort, so that the stone is deep enough. The tension can hold it together. As it gets shoulder and shoulder, the tension necessary to offset this has to be greater and greater. Can you feel that, right? This is a lever here. So the deeper it is, the less effort to hold it together. So the Greeks used a very, very deep stone, and they only could span a very short distance between those columns. Go and look at the Parthenon, and you'll see those stones that are up there are cracking too on the bottom. You can see where they're trying to come apart. So we see you got a very ancient, like Mycenae, and you got a very small gate and a very deep stone. When they wanted to have any greater spans, they had to go to wood. So we find in all the antiquities all these verticals, because the verticals are where gravity is holding it together. Once you go horizontal, gravity is trying to break it apart. So beautiful gravity holding together vertically, this way she works against it. Our old friend, angular valving of gravity here. So we have the human beings then using wooden, because wood, the masonry has said only 50 pounds a square inch, and wood you could get up to 10. And if you get really very fancy woods, you get up to birch, very special swatches of birch, you might get up to 25,000. But wood, the tensile strengths of wood would be 5, 7, 10. 10,000 is very strong wood in tensile strength. But 10,000 as against 50 is very high. So, but wood was perishable, rotted and burnt and so forth. So that in antiquity we have all the verticals where gravity is holding together with the stone, and the horizontals have gone, because they, if they're any span at all, because they were wood and rotted out. However, I want you to, and so I said, if an earthquake came along, the whole thing went down. There is really no important brilliance here, really, of a very powerful general, and he had enough slaves and captives, so forth, simply keep piling on the stone. There may be some artistic character around, so you like to have him chip the stone a little fancy for you. Or you like to have, the general wants his name written in the stone there, or some picture of him. So there are people that had to do some superficial decorating, but engineering-wise, it was just a matter of pure muscle. And not really mind at all. But this business of tension begin to introduce something to you, and the principle of leverage we talked about is a generalized principle and has very important discrete usability. So we come to a ship of the sea. People found then, I spoke yesterday about the three-quarters of the earth being covered with water, 10% dry, 25% dry land, but only about half of that that was not rocks and deserts and ice. And getting down to around 1% that is immediately propitious to support human life, where the things were growing, there were grapes to be eaten, there were bananas, whatever it is, and people could get going. And the people continually find themselves, where nature went against it, there was a drought and things that didn't grow that year, and so they were suddenly in mortal peril. And we went into the development of the city-state, or these walls, stone walls, and what the people who did find a very favorable place did was, like Mycenae and the beautiful Argolian plains, they had found a hill in the middle of the valley, quite high, it had a well, and they built a great stone wall up there, and then they built stone grain bins, and when they saw the enemy coming through the passes, they took all the food and put it inside, and they scorched the field, so the people came outside and they were very hungry already. You only go 30 days without food, approximately, so just watch the people outside wilt away. We have then Other people have found the water had fish in, and you could live on that. But the water might look very beautiful down at the harbor there one day, and suddenly you go out there in the sea and an enormous storm comes from it. So the people found they really couldn't go off on the three-quarters of the earth, which is water, in any important degree, until they began to have better and better boats, because once you think about a boat, and you've got a big wave, and the boat is then a beam between these two waves. You see that, right? So the boat is then being a beam. My arms are the peaks of two waves, and my boat is between the two, so it's trying to do this. A minute later, the wave is in the middle of the boat, and then wants to go that way. So it's being racked this way and that way. Fantastic stresses, incredible stresses. Now, the difference between going to sea and being on the land is just incredible. Number one, I gave you, remember, crystallines, liquids, and gases. And the crystallines have a triple bonded, three times, a lot of tension to hold them together there. That the liquids were hinged, so they distributed loads, and the gases were universally jointed, so they distributed loads, but were compressible, and the liquids are non-compressible. When we then get the amount of energy necessary to disturb the crystalline in the universe, it takes three times as much to disturb the crystalline as it does to disturb the gaseous. And only twice as much takes twice as much to disturb the liquid as it does to move the gases. In the universe, one of the most interesting part of the great patterns of energy is I gave you yesterday the degrees of freedom, the way energies can get within any given move you have. When you're turned to play, you get six positive, six negative moves you can make. And you can get way out. And I showed you how we got distance differentials entering into the total experience. And so we have energies dispersed and expanding universe. We've been into our syntropy and entropy and so forth. I'd like then to come to the thinking of fundamental experience, which is that relation to wave and frequency, the big ones. Fundamental to energy in quantum mechanics, you start with the universe has a given amount of energy, and you can invest that energy into a lot of little things or a few big things. You're going to be able to get it back again and reinvest it, but generally the universe has the big things, then it cannot happen as often. So the novae are really very infrequent. Novae are very infrequent. Earthquakes are not so very frequent. Mosquitoes are very high frequency. The smaller, the more frequent the way of energy behavior. So that the earthquakes occur on the land, rarely do you have enough energy motion on the earth to break the triple bond. Very frequently we have enough energies to disturb the water, only double bond. And even more frequently we have enough energy to disturb the air. So we find then the waves in the crystalline, the earthquake wave is just really a little tremor, a very small wave. But our waves in the water can get up as much as 10-story building at night. And the waves in the air get up to mile high. So it takes relatively little energy to make enormous disturbances in the atmosphere and relatively small to make disturbance in liquid, but very rarely to have enough to have earthquake, sea quake every day almost, and airquake all the time. The interface between the liquid and the gaseous then is one with very high frequency untoward enormous stresses are operative. And so you just cannot go out with a ship in the sea unless you really develop a capability, an engineering capability, dealing in principles in every kind of way, really understanding your tension and compression in an extraordinary way, understanding hydraulics and pneumatics, very fundamental ways. Okay. On the land, as you do, you can have a job, and so you work for 8 hours and then call it a day. You can close all the shutters on the cottage and say that's the end of it. At sea you can't shut down. It's a 24-hour job. She just simply continually comes to magnitudes of forced interaction with you and your ship. You've just got to be on the job. So, man then lived 24 hours, and on, say, if he had a long day, and maybe he had 12-hour day in the land, he at least had twice as much experience, you see, because he got 24 hours out of every day of experience instead of 12. So the experience piled up very, very rapidly, and the severity of the untoward events, very high frequency. Therefore, those people who did come back are very aware of so many how didn't come back, and they went into anticipation. This is our friend, comprehensive anticipatory design science. What are all the things you're going to have to anticipate? Furthermore, your ship, you had to carry, going to get any real distance, carry lots of food, and it brings you into all kinds of problems supplying that crew. So we find the ship going very rapidly, differentiating into pure tension and pure compression, getting into what does make flexible cables. We've been into a lot of that. I've been into necklaces and structures with you, so that you understand what I'm saying here. But the ship really very quickly accelerated man's familiarity with differentiated tension, compressioning, angular controls, leverage advantages, whatever it may be. And you find the earliest known picture of a ship is one on the caves of one of the priests in Egypt. And that first ship, if you are an engineer, you recognize she's a good-sized ship. Her complexity technologically was several masts. The tensionings and the compressionings and the triangulations that are in it are just phenomenal. At that time, the tools that were pictured on the walls of that Egyptian priest were very, very advanced tools for making the ship. In contradistinction to anything being used on land at that time, a wooden plow. The tools of the land were just childish and compared to the tools of that sea. That ship, quite clearly, if anybody gets into such matters, the evolution rate of which technology doesn't prove, would realize that that ship had been in development for 50,000 years. She's a fantastically mature affair. I'm not saying that ship was built. The information went in there that was actually coped with and employed in principle to make that ship a success was of thousands of years accumulation. Now, number one, on the land, they get the sea quake. If a flood comes along, you're completely licked. On the sea, it's a flood all the time. So you're designed for a flood, you better stay on top of it. And your castle won't stay on top of it. So you can't have that stone kind of thing out there in the sea. Gradually, I became, as more I studied these matters, the more I became aware that the science and engineering of building of ships of the sea and then later out of the sky were thousands of years ahead of the art of just building on the land, anything that weight and strong that sort of didn't tip over, gravity holding together. So even as I grew up, we have the insurance companies saying, you know, strong as a rock of Gibraltar, and the idea was just inertia. And we don't get over that idea of the inertia, and society is yet not over it till the last great walls with those of the Maginot Line, and suddenly, boom, World War II is all over. Why? What happened was that World War I, the submarine coming along, the tank and the submarine were coming out of the sea, their technology of the sea. And they simply climbed up on, up this time, you couldn't carry any great cargoes on the land at all. Railroad began to carry the great cargoes, but you'd have to have the great canals, you had to float things. The ocean, you can have incredibly large ships. Once you load your cargo, you can get it thousands of miles. And ships could carry loads that human beings couldn't carry in their backs and couldn't carry in the backs of animals. As Sir Halford Mackinder showed in the English long ago, that when the railroad came along, they started the Marine Railway, the first railway was a Marine Railway, built a ship to lay down in the sea using gravity to accelerate it in. And you had, then with the Marine Railway, the ship could tip over. But they then doubled the idea so that your ship won't tip over, and this became the railroad, and they ran the tracks back up on the land, they developed the steam engine for the ship, and so they put it on the donkey engine on the thing and run it back up on the land. So so Halford McKinder showed the English the railroads were the ship technology coming up on the land, this advanced engineering really coming up on the land. And he warned the English that the coastline was not where they thought it was because of the ability to carry great cargoes suddenly up on the land. But the World War II tanks and so forth, what was called the Blitzkrieg, was the water technology coming up on the land, because on land you had siege, and it's a trench wall, you just stay in, siege. But what happened long ago with the human beings developing city-states and the success of city-states being such as Mycenae, sometimes they became so successful that they had chance to also get into producing boats. And probably the fall of Troy is the beginning of the city-state masters building ships. And the Greeks had these ships, and they then were able then to come up to the castle. Up this time, the people outside the walls simply starved. But suddenly the invaders came along with ships, and the ships could keep going off. The people inside of Troy just had so much food, they thought it was going to be great, that the people outside just going to starve. But the people who came along were not starving. They had ships bringing incredible cargoes. So suddenly the line of supply began to be the new grand strategy of who is going to survive on our planet. And we find then the time of, you look at Italy, all those great castellos commanding these different valleys, and they're great overlords, giving themselves their name they want to. And suddenly the man who's been developing ships, coming into, he's able to carry enormous cannon and so forth, he comes into harbor in Italy, there's a great castello there, and he just lets him have a couple of shots, and he said, I don't want you to know anymore about my grand strategy, because at sea, three-quarters of the earth being covered with water, the people who then built ships and built them to carry great cargoes from great distances with enormous, extraordinary risk to do it, did not tell the other man where they were going, when they would be back, or what they're going to have on board. Because the ocean is so big that the curvature of the earth, as we say, the man's down under the horizon, 14 miles away from the sailing ship. And so that the sea kept her secrets. The people then who went to sea and were going to produce enormous wealth by synergetics of getting resources that exist over here that don't exist at home, but other resources exist at home that seem to have no usefulness. But you bring these two together, and suddenly they produce something of enormous advantage, and great wealth has been generated. So that just when I was young, even the expression still was very, very prevalent, because I actually grew up with it, well, just at the tail end of the clipper ship times. And they say, if you just wait till my ship comes in, one ship in, and it's a fortune. It was an enormous big risk to build that thing, but if you could endure for that thing, it would work. But you didn't want, no time at all, when you go to sea, to find the people who were able to build the very best ships had to be very powerful overlords on the land, because they had to be able to say, I'm going to build a ship. And had to be able to say, I want all you people who produce, all you woodworkers come down and build my ship. I want all you metalworkers come and work on my ship. I want all you people who have been sewing, making clothing, to make sails for my ship. They had to command the whole economy, and they had to say, all you people now grow food for my people working on my ship. That would be very powerful overlords. And to consolidate, had to have a very good advisor, very good designer, who's been well appraised of the experience of others before us. So he builds this great risky ship. Then there's another overlord who's not anywhere nearly as powerful, and he's very jealous of him. So he says, I know, very easy, I can just build a smaller ship. and I got to wait outside the harbor until the night before he gets home, we just take him over. And piracy became very, very popular. And simply crashing on the water, incidentally, at no time historically, because the people on the land anywhere enforced their laws out on the water any further than you could throw something. And projectile, so 3 mile limit, so forth. But the law, three quarters of the earth is outside the law, and the people who then lived in that water ocean world really became world people, were inherently outlaws. And you find the top ones are called sovereigns, and the other ones are just pirates. So the great pirate became sovereign and gained great respect. In fact, they told everybody in the world exactly how you carry on. And they set the standards. We find the, what came about, changed a lot of this, and this mathematics. I did not talk to you about the Arabic numerals, did I? The Arabic numerals and the Roman numerals, you're familiar with the Roman numerals. Would you ever try to do any multiplication of the Roman numerals? Or division? How do you get on? You don't get on. The Roman numerals invented, again, I've talked about power structure. The power structure, man could have anybody, very ignorant slave, say, I want you to stand here, and every time a sheep goes by, make a scratch. It was a scoring system, and had to do with things that kept life going. And this was the wealth. So every time a bag of wheat goes by, you make a scratch. And then there was a supervisor, and he come along and make a secondary kind of his kind of check mark. It's like our V check mark today. So we have the scoring, and people, the whole Mediterranean world, the Roman Empire, using the scoring system. Not until 700 A.D. does it come into what you and I were taught historically of civilization around that Mediterranean world. 700 A.D., the Arabic numerals begin to come in, but they're employed by people as a shorthand for the Roman numerals. So it was easier to go like that than to make three marks. And they were just thought of that way. The Arabic numerals, however, they had the cipher in it. And in the scoring system, you can't eat no sheep, so you didn't need a symbol for no sheep. You just wouldn't know exactly how many no sheep there were, how many symbols you needed it. So the cipher had absolutely no meaning to the people who used Roman numerals, because it was a scoring system. So they thought that the cipher of the Arabic numerals was some sort of a decoration, so it's a period that you put at the end of your work, whatever it is. And so the Arabic numerals then came into the Roman world, the total Mediterranean world, in 700 A.D. It was not until 500 years later, 1200 A.D., that a treatise is written by a Latin in North Africa explaining the cipher, the function of the cipher. Now, my own speculative going back into things of the archaeology of the sea, which I've been so interested in, and the evolution of design of ships at various places due to the kind of woods they had and the kind of waters they had to fish or whatever it might be. I'm not forgetting my Arabic numerals and so forth, but just I mentioned earlier an archaeology of the sea where I was very fundamentally aware as a sailor that they were building ships in the Sea of Arabia exactly as they described being built in the Bible. When human beings did go out in the water and were safely back, they began to like that particular ship very, very much. And you couldn't get those people who are building the ships and sailing them to change once they found a fairly successful one. So I found that the boats all around the world, they were quite different. You went around one cape into another. The fishing conditions were different. The seas were different. The different woods to work with. And so it was fascinating to me, the different types that were around the world, but they'd been holding steady for thousands of years. And I could see the interrelationship, and you could see which one came before the other. So I saw there really was a visible evolution, and archaeology, and the sea was still operating over the thousands of years, and the land one, it over long ago, and you're burying it. And I'm uncovering it and trying to put some shards together, but this is something you could really get tremendous information. The fact that you could carry those cargoes enormous distances, and that people are still using ships in exactly the same way they had been. One will go to India today and still see the numbers is extraordinary. Boats of yesterday have been running the monsoon seas for thousands. Those captains say they've been sailing between Africa and India for 10,000 years. That's their own reckoning. But the very little evolutionary change, and you learn exactly which ship could come before the other, and why the kind of winds or whatever the condition did what they did. So I became tremendously interested in being able to explain history from the water side in contradistinction to trying to piece it together archaeologically on the land side. So there are relatively few people there. It had to make sense. It was an engineering kind of logic that would be much, much more revealing, I felt, than the kind of things that people with their superstitions and so forth on the land, they could kid themselves into even though this was historically the way it was, it didn't necessarily have to be very logical. I come back to the abacus. I'm quite confident I spoke to you about the probability of life really beginning on those South Sea Islands. And what I'm saying to you now is tending to prove to be correct. My theory of a half century ago is getting to be very, very highly substantiated. During World War I, beginning outside of World War I, the Germans controlled the Caroline Islands in the Pacific, and on one of the Caroline Islands, the most eastward of it, the German commander suddenly found himself being, the English ships had come in and taking him over. He wanted to get word quickly, because the World War I had not been announced. He wanted to get word to his commander, who was on an island 1,000 miles to the west. There was a legend on the islands that the people, the sailors with their outrigger canoes, very fast sailing proas, that they were able to go offshore, off of soundings. They somehow were able to navigate. And so he gave a message to the leading navigator's boatman there and asked him if he could get this message to his commander 1,000 miles to the west. The answer came back in a few weeks. He had done so. This is the first time the Europeans ever knew that the Pacific Island sailors did know how to sail off soundings and work on celestial navigation of some kind. There was an enormous European conceit that went along with the Magellans and the Drakes and so forth going around the world seeming to be very superior to their ships, and thinking about those people, naked people in the Pacific that don't know anything, just very ignorant people naked. Since World War II, when the United States had had a very large mandate to deal with in the Pacific, the Navy's had to do greater work, and it is now generally conceded by the students of maritime science that navigation clearly began in the South Seas, in the Pacific. There are various things that I can tell you about this that are to me very fascinating, because I became a student of this subject. If I take the large map of the world, and we can go, let's look at my map over here. This Pacific, the Great Pacific Basin, all this enormous area in here, coming down to the South Seas are in here. And this enormous Pacific Basin, there's something very important. The language is all the same language for this enormous area. There are alliterations and dialects that come from it, but it's all one language. There was a professor who was at my Southern Illinois University in Illinois, and then he went out to the East-West Institute in Hawaii, and he was a great expert on that language, and he also then put the problem into the computer. You can tell, if you're an expert in languages, what is an alliteration, what is the prominent way of saying this, and the ignorant way of saying it, how things change. Taking all the pronunciations on the Pacific and using vectors, it found that all the languages of the Pacific, which are all the same, all went back to the island of New Britain, just east of New Guinea, right here. Now, in the get into New Guinea, and get over a mountain, and there's another valley, and there's people. Valley after valley, and there are hundreds and hundreds of tribes all speaking completely different languages, nothing to do with each other. The minute you get on the land and the difficulty to get from here to there, you get really, really separate languages, but these water people, all the same language. Due to the fact you go incredible distances on the sea, in the history of the Maori, who had been to Hawaii, and historically it's known that they made several trips from your friend Jim Mitchell wrote the beautiful book of Hawaii. They've made several trips, times they've been up in the Pacific and then gone back to New Zealand, where the headquarters are now. Those have been hundreds of years apart before they've gone back to, for a moment, some kind of headquarters. In the language of the water people of the Pacific, Maori, they were thought by the Europeans to be extraordinarily ignorant because they said they could only count up to two. They were using the binary system long, long ago. As we get in the computer world, we suddenly realized this is the way to carry on, so that you have to revise your appraisal of people on the basis of this, they couldn't do any better. Also, all these water people were considered to be very low order man because they, in the first place, they didn't have any literature. Anybody had any culture would have a literature. Now, the fact is that if you live on the sea, you can't have any library out on a raft. The ocean's going to go over you, and that's not the way you're going to handle your information in printed or on paper, so forth. The Maori have kept their history entirely by memory, and they teach the children their history. And when you come to the land places where the Maori will exist from time to time, they have these long houses and they have columns of the house and the ribs of the roof, which are originally the ribs of the ship. And each of these columns is an ancestor. And they sing their chants about their ancestors. They're able to go back about 100 ancestors, and I doubt if you can go back 4 or 5. They rarely memorize it, and their words and their chants say things they don't even know what they mean, but from father to son, they learn to say it that way. So if you do get any kind of key, you can really open it up. But it's been then carried on verbally rather than being on printed paper and so forth. These water people then, being naked, don't have any pockets, and you're going to have some important information. I'm getting these what are called the long ears, where they split the ears, and ears can't open like that, and then here, these big discs, those have turned out to be actually cardinal points of the compass. This was a very extraordinary piece. Nothing could get off your neck and their arms, so these various rings and things they're wearing are ways in which you do calculations of things. These are the only pockets you have if you're naked on the sea. Not going to lose. Very important information. So things have been looked at as strange, as so strange to the European, that so this is a wild, wild people. Are very, very mature, very economic, very efficient kind of information controlling devices. Now, one of the most interesting things you get into mathematics and the number, the language of science. Beautiful book by, I don't say his name quickly. It will come in a little bit. In the number, the language of science, one of the classics, there is a listing of the names for numbers in different languages, all the different tongues of our earth. In the world of etymology, the world of the science of words, there are some words that are called old words that transcend any ability to trace how, where they came from, what they're all about. Amongst the old words, there are very few of them, all the names for the numbers are old words. They don't know where they came from, except for one word, for the name for five is very often identified with the roots for the hand. But all the other numbers are absolutely, there's no physical experience that anywhere connected with the word. They're apparently really abstractions, the words for abstractions. At any rate, if you see the names for these numbers in different languages all around the world, Tobias Danzig is the author of Number of the Language of Science. If you look at his list then, these names, and I'm going to say to you, one of these two words means one and the other means two in these different languages. I want you to tell me which one means one, one, two. You'll never have any trouble. You suddenly find that it actually is a quite great similarity of these. And it goes running through them. The names for the numbers have very important similarities.